So we've now moved into transport of our chemical messengers. So what have we done so far? Let me take a look at our outline so that you know where we're going. We've talked about the chemical properties of our chemical messengers. The last video reviewed how our chemical messengers are synthesized and secreted from the secretory cell. Now, we want to investigate how those chemical messengers get transported to the target cell. Here's a pictorial view of what we've just mentioned. So we've already discussed synthesis and secretion of that ligand from the secretory cell. And you know that that's going to be based on whether or not your chemical messenger is lipophobic or lipophilic. Now, we will want to know how the ligand gets transported. In other words, when it's being transported to the target cell, how exactly does that happen? And once again, we return to this table of the chemical classification of chemical messengers. What I would suggest doing now is adding in a column header for transport. Again, how your chemical messenger, how your ligand is being transported, is dependent upon the chemical property. So whether your ligand is lipophobic or lipophilic will determine how it's transported. We have two different options for transport. One, transport of your ligand through the interstitial fluid, or two, blood-borne transport. Okay, so let's take a closer look at how this will work. If the diffusion is only through the interstitial fluid, then the secretory cell and your target are nearby. So this would include your neurotransmitters and your paracrine signalers. These ligands will not stay around forever, however. They are quickly degraded when diffusion occurs through the interstitial fluid. Blood-borne transport, on the other hand, is a little more complicated, and it's going to be dependent upon whether the ligand is lipophobic or lipophilic. Blood-borne transport occurs when the secretory cell and the target cell are far away. In other words, long-distance communication. And that's what's occurring when we have hormones and neurohormones as our ligands. One thing to keep in mind is that the plasma is mostly water. So if your ligand is hydrophilic, it loves water. So will it freely mix with the water that's in the blood? Water and water mix, right? Or hydrophilic ligands and water, they love each other. And so what we say here is that the ligand will dissolve in the plasma. Now, if your ligand, on the other hand, is hydrophobic, it fears the water. So if this ligand is afraid of water, is it going to want to mingle with the water? Hopefully, you said no, because it's going to be afraid of the water. It wants to try to hide from the water. I mean, the ligand will bind to a carrier protein. That carrier protein is present in the plasma. So again, the ligand is hydrophobic. It's afraid of the water, so it's hiding from the water by being bound to a carrier protein. Now, one of the things about hydrophobic ligands is that only about 99% of hydrophobic ligands are actually bound to carrier proteins. Let's take a look at why. Begin with our signaling cell. This is also called the secretory cell. We've been using the term secretory cell all along, so we'll stay with that terminology. When the secretory cell produces a hormone, we know that it travels out here to the interstitial fluid, and then it winds up in the blood. So here, you can see you've got your messenger, the same thing as your ligand, or in this case, our hormone, is the orange square. The green indicates your carrier protein. So you can see that some of these, or 99% of them, are bound to carrier proteins. But you have some free hormones, some free hydrophobic ligands, in other words. So why do we have to have 1% free? In other words, they're not bound to a carrier protein, and why? Why is that? The free messenger comes out of the blood and binds to the receptor within the target cell. Now that means we have fewer, or In other words, a decreased concentration of free messengers in the plasma. That then causes the bound messengers to disassociate from their carrier protein. So this is what stimulates those bound ligands to fall off or to be removed from their carrier protein. And once they're removed, they can diffuse into the target cell. Your hydrophobic ligands cannot stay bound to the carrier protein and then diffuse into the target cell. Your ligand has to be removed from the carrier protein, leaving your carrier protein back in the plasma.